We are delighted to be together. I should give you a disclaimer that today may not be your conventional sermon. I want us to provoke one another and to good things.
Leo haitakuwa mafunzo yetu ya kawaida, lakini kuna mambo ambayo nataka tushiriki pamoja.
And media team, you can get ready. Our key text, which is Judges chapter 2. We shall read from verse 6
tutasoma
all the way to 15.
Waamuzi 2 mstari wa 6 hadi 15.
And we, as we seek to provoke one another, we want to have a bit of a conversation.
Tutakuwa na mjadala ama mazungumzo.
As we reflect on how well we are doing when it comes to passing on our faith to the next generation.
Kujikumbusha jinsi tunaelewa tunapopitisha imani yetu kwa kizazi kijacho.
And again, another disclaimer, here we shall be asking ourselves a few questions. We shall be looking at the biblical text, we shall be looking at our context, and we shall be looking at our prospects.
Tutakuwa tunajiuliza maswali kupitia kwa Biblia na pia katika muktadha ya maisha yetu.
What does it look like going forward? Where are we? And what do we see from scripture? Where are we coming from? Are there lessons we can learn? Are there challenges we can see from others who have done life before us?
Yeah, tutaangalia kuhusu ni tunaelekea wapi, tumejifunza nini kutoka katika maandiko, na kuna changamoto ambazo zinaelekezwa katika maisha yetu na wengine.
And the speaker needs to learn to slow down, because in the first service he spoke without an interpreter.
Ibada ya kwanza ni nena bila mtafsiri.
But he is my friend, so I'll talk to him. The speaker, that is.
Amen.
And I come to this
nakuja hapa
as a seriously interested party.
Kama yule ambaye ana makusudia sana.
You know, a seriously interested party in a deal is somebody who has some skin in the game.
Ni yule mtu ambaye ako na uelewaji fulani katika huo mchezo.
Actually, having your skin in the game, that's a very Australian phrase. I used to have a friend who mentored me, who was Australian. You say, Joshua, have you got some skin in that game?
Nilikuwa na rafiki yangu pale Australia, alikuwa na mazoefu kwa hiyo kwa mchezo.
It means you have a stake in something. You have something to lose if it does not go well.
So when I mambo hayataenda jinsi unavyotaka.
When I say on this topic I have some skin in the game,
nikisema niko na makusudia katika huo mchezo,
what we are talking about today concerns me seriously and severely.
Ni kile ambacho naongelea leo kinanihusu sana mimi mwenyewe.
Because more disclosure, earlier in the first service there was an announcement about an event for people who have been married for over 25 years.
Katika ibada ya kwanza kulikuwa na matangazo kuhusu wale ambao wamaoana zaidi ya miaka 25.
And I don't think I've ever had an announcement like that before. So I turned to Bishop Kimani and I said, "Hey, haya. Nagundua I'm in that space."
Yeye pia anajieleza kumbe ako pale katika hiyo kikundi.
So we are parents of Sarah and I, we are parents of an 18-year-old and a 16-year-old and a 15-year-old this week.
Tuko na sisi ni wazazi wa watoto watatu miaka 18, 16
na tano. So na tano. So sisi tulimaliza hiyo maneno haraka ndio tufanye shughuli zingine, and then actually it matters to me as we speak about passing on our faith,
intergenerational faith.
So that underlines my coming to this as an interested party. You get it?
Yeye inanionyesha maana gani ni mimi nahusika katika mambo hayo ninapokuja hapa.
Also, I come to this as a pastor. I come to this as someone who now works in the youth space, in the universities, and what I see,
kile ambacho naweza kuona,
is very exciting.
Ni kile ambacho hicho kupendeza sana.
The prospects are amazing.
Mambo ambayo tunajua ni mazuri.
Yeah? We can do the diagnosis, but the prognosis, I'm a doctor, but not a medical one. So the outlook from where we stand is, it could be wonderful. But if it is to be wonderful and not go the other way, we have responsibility, and that's basically the
space. Itakuwa ni njema, kuna majukumu ambayo yanafaa kutimilika.
Yes, allow me to read the scripture and then we shall continue. Yes, Judges chapter 2.
Waamuzi mlango wa pili.
And starting with verse 6. I will read from the NIV. This is what it says. After Joshua had dismissed the Israelites, they went to take possession of the land, each to his own inheritance. The people served the Lord throughout the lifetime of Joshua and of the elders who outlived him and who had seen all the great things the Lord had done for Israel. Joshua, son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110. They buried him in the land of his inheritance at Timnath-Heres in the hill country of Ephraim, north of Mount Geash. After that whole generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served the Baals. They forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of Egypt. They followed and worshipped the various gods of the peoples around them. They provoked the Lord to anger because he forsook him and served Baal and the Ashtoreths. In his anger against Israel, the Lord handed them over to raiders who plundered them. He sold them to their enemies all around, whom they were no longer able to resist. Whenever Israel went out to fight, the hand of the Lord was against them to defeat them, just as he had sworn to them. They were in great distress. I don't know what comes to mind when you hear that text. I will tell you the truth. When I read that text, I have a problem with verse 10. You know the one I read slowly? I stammer often when I read that one. Because it kind of sounds like the other one. Remember the other one that says, then there arose a Pharaoh who did not know Joseph. In my current season, I teach theology at the School of Theology at Park University. And as you read the Bible, there are certain texts that is like a speed bump. I don't drive fast, but I occasionally hit speed bumps, especially at night. The other night I hit one, karibu niite Yesu na Maria na Yusufu. You know? So this verse is like boom. You are going smoothly, then boop. It forces you to kind of come to your senses. That's why I'm comparing you to the other one. Alafu paka inuka farao ambaye hakujua Yusufu, and it's a complete change of direction for the people of God. This one says, after Joshua and his generation of elders who had seen what the Lord had done, had died, that generation, then there arose a generation that neither knew the Lord nor what he had done for Israel.
Wala kila ambacho alitendea Israeli.
You see, my problem is this.
Shida yangu ni hii.
If you are mentioning another minor character in the Old Testament, in the story of the Exodus, and I would understand.
Kama unalinganisha tu mtu yote kwa Biblia ambaye ni mdogo, nitaweza kuelewa.
Sasa na ubaya, mimi naitwanishwa na huyu jamaa Joshua.
I'm called by the name Joshua,
which compounds my problem.
Ambayo inazingira shida yangu.
What generation is this that's being mentioned here? Ya kina ati Joshua na kina Caleb.
Kizazi cha Joshua na Caleb.
You know who those people were?
Unajua walikuwa kina nani?
You know what they did?
Unajua walifanya nini?
Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. These are men who believed God. In fact, the testimony of Caleb is that he trusted, he believed, he had confidence in what God is able to do. These are people who knew their God. They did exploits. So then when I see mentioned alongside them and associated with them that after them arose a generation that neither knew the Lord or what he had done for Israel.
Baada ya hapo kizazi ambacho kinakuja ni kila ambacho hawakumjui Mungu na wala ambacho Mungu alifanyia watu wa Israeli.
I am seriously disturbed.
Hiyo kinanisumbua sana.
If there were no consequences to it.
Kama hangekuwa na matarajio matokeo mabaya.
We might excuse it.
Atungesema ni sawa.
But look at the verses that follow verse 10.
Lakini angalia mifungo ambazo zinafuatia mstari wa 10.
It greets. It's kind of content you don't want to associate with God's people.
Ni muktadha ambao hauelekezi watu wa Mungu.
And let's look at that very briefly.
Wacha tuangalie kwa uchache.
The consequences.
Madhara yake.
And of course, I can't even look at the consequences without first telling you that my disturbance makes me ask these two questions.
Kusumbuliwa kwangu kunafanya niulize maswali haya mawili.
Ati who? Joshua and Caleb. Really?
Joshua na Caleb. Kweli?
There's some element of disbelief for me.
Kuna hali ya kutoamini ndani yangu.
And the second question that it leads me to ask is this.
Swali la pili ni hili.
Haya, how?
Namna gani? Aje?
Kuna mambo unaambiagwa unaona ngumu sana ku wrestle your brain around.
Ni swali gumu ambalo linafanya unakuwa na mawazo mengi katika kichwa chako.
Eh? Ni kama uambiwe leo ati Joshua Rutere is the president of America. You see, really? How?
Utasema kweli namna gani?
Kweli namna gani? Yaani it distorts logic, isn't it?
Inaharibu ukawaida.
So then it leads me to ask what happened?
Nini kilifanyika?
What happened?
Nini ilifanyika?
Because clearly something happened.
Kwa ukweli kuna kitu kilitendeka.
Somebody dropped the ball.
Mtu aliangusha kitu.
Eh? Kuna mtu aliangusha kijiti. Kuna kitu na kijiti. Yeah, actually you're right. But something dropped.
Kitu
and if somebody dropped, then somebody dropped something.
Kuna mtu aliangusha kitu.
Sawa sawa. If the chain broke, then somebody somewhere where they were standing, they broke the chain.
Kama mnyororo likatika, kuna ule ambaye alikata huyo mnyororo.
But let's look at the consequences now.
Wacha tuangalie madhara yake sasa.
Of not knowing the Lord.
Kwa kutomjua Mungu.
Know what he had done for.
Kutojua kila ambacho alifanya mwanzo.
But to help you, to even make it more serious, so you understand my dilemma.
Kuifanya ikuwe ni kitu ya makusudi sana, unielewe.
How are kina Joshua and Caleb supposed to behave?
Joshua na Caleb walikuwa nafanya nani? Walikuwa wanajihusisha namna gani?
It takes us to Deuteronomy chapter 6.
Inatupeleka pale kumbukumbu ya Torati mlango wa 6.
How they were to handle what the Lord had done. Let me read that.
Jinsi wangefanya venye Mungu alikuwa amewaahidi.
And this is what it says.
Inasema hivi.
After the instruction to love the Lord from verse 4 of chapter 6. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. Now listen to the next bit. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home. Who are you sitting with? And when you walk along the road, who are you walking with? When you lie down and when you get up, tie them as symbols on your hands. Bind them on your foreheads. Write them on your door frames of your houses and on your gates. How then did there arise a generation which neither knew nor what he had done for?
Kilitokea wapi kizazi hiki ambacho hakikielewa kila ambacho alifanya Mungu?
So you see what I'm getting at?
Unaelewa kila ambacho
somebody dropped the ball.
Kuna mtu
somebody broke the chain.
Kuna mtu hakujukumika mahali.
And we mentioned diagnosis and prognosis earlier.
Na tukaongelea wewe utafiti mwanzo.
Actually, as I read the Bible,
Biblia,
as I study scripture,
maandiko,
I see a small diagnostic possibility.
Naona utafiti fulani.
And Bishop, I should say this now from here.
Wacha ni seme nikiwa hapa askofu.
I teach public speaking, eh?
Nafundisha kuongea kwa umati.
That's why the president never comes here. He always speaks from there.
Niposa rais yeye huongea nyuma.
Because he says, President of the Republic of...
Kwa sababu inasema raisi wa Kenya.
So when the president comes here, it's not the president speaking, okay?
Anapo kuja hapa kando, yeye siyo raisi ambaye anaongea.
Bishop, today allow me to stretch our thinking, yeah?
Niruhusu nipanue mawazo yetu.
What I say here, earlier Bishop, I said it's a bit, and I saw him do this. Good, that is it. What I say from this side is, tunatafakari, sindio? Could it be that part of the diagnostic possibility here?
Inawezekana kwamba mmoja wapo utafiti mahali hapa
might be associated with, just could be.
Inaweza kuwa inahusiana na kitu tu.
You know that scripture we hang in our houses? Joshua 24 verse.
Joshua 24 mstari.
As for me and my, we shall serve the.
Mimi na nyumba yangu tutamtumikia Bwana.
You know what it says before that? The verse behind it.
Unajua maneno baada kabla.
It says nyinyi watu.
You people.
Chagueni.
Choose.
Mkitaka kutumikia ile miungu ya huko mlikotoka.
If you want to serve the gods where you came from.
Au ya huko mnakoenda.
Where you're going.
Shauri yenu. Lakini mimi na nyumba yangu.
Me and my house.
Tutatumikia.
We shall serve the Lord.
Shauri.
Shauri.
Lakini mimi na nyumba yangu.
Me and my house.
That's why he said it from here. Sawa sawa. Are our children safe if we say shauri yenu kwa community?
Je, watoto wetu wako mahali pazuri tunaposema shauri yenu?
Are children safe if we say shauri yenu to our school education?
Je, tunapoachilia watu katika shule tunasema watoto wetu wako na usalama kweli?
Are we safe if we say shauri yenu to law enforcement and by the way, let me make a public confession. The police in Kenya are now among my best friends.
Wacha niseme hivi, wa askari ni marafiki zangu sana hapa Kenya.
They used to be my big enemies.
Walikuanga maadui kitambo.
Until I started praying for them.
Na wakati nianza kuwaombea.
And until I could not cross a roadblock without praying for them.
Na nikaanza kuwaombea singepita barabara kabla niwaombee.
And praying that curse will not cross the next generation.
Na nikasema hiyo laana isiingie katika kizazi kijacho.
If I tell you now, and I mean it by the way.
Na maanisha.
In fact, I stop these days to greet the police.
Uwa nasimama kuwasalimia kwa barabara.
Because from the top to the bottom they become my...
Kuanzia juu chini wamekuwa marafiki wangu.
That's an aside. Are we safe we say shauri yenu to the law enforcement and the legal systems in Kenya?
Je, tuko salama tunapowaachilia na kusema shauri yenu?
That's a small diagnostic possibility. Let's continue.
Yenu utafiti mdogo tu tuendelee.
We will come back to the second one.
Tutakuja kwa ya pili.
Consequences. The first one is in verse 11.
Mstari wa 11.
That the Israelites, since they did not know the Lord or what he had done for Israel, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and served
walifanya
the Baals.
Mabaya katika macho ya Mungu.
Na wakatumikia hiyo miungu ya sanamu. Verse 12, the second consequence. They forsook the Lord.
Walimuacha Mungu.
And you know what it says in verse 12?
Inasema nini mstari wa 12?
They forsook the Lord.
Walimuacha Mungu.
God of their fathers.
Mungu wa baba yao.
Who had brought them out of? It does not say here they forsook the Lord their God.
Haisemi walimuacha Mungu wao.
Inasema they forsook the Lord, the God of mom and dad.
Walimuacha Mungu wa wazazi wao.
That's another diagnostic possibility.
Hiyo ni utafiti mwingine pia pale.
Kwamba Mungu hakuwa Mungu wao.
It was not their God.
Ni Mungu wa mom na dad.
It was the God of their fathers.
You see that?
Unaona hiyo?
That one I don't know whether to say here or there or in between.
Sijui ndaisema nikiwa wapi.
But it's here, okay? That's a serious... Sisi tulisema kuna kitu ili drop. It tells you somebody, wamelelewa pale walikuwa wapossessed, lakini wako outside. Wana reference Mungu wa baba na...
Wanahusia ule Mungu wa baba yao.
Consequence number 3, verse 12
still.
They followed and worshipped various gods of people around them.
Walifuata na kuabudu miungo, miungu ya watu wengine.
And by so doing, verse 13 again, another outcome, they provoked the Lord to anger.
Walimfanya Mungu akawe na hasira.
And they did that because they forsook him and they turned the Baals and the Ashtoreths.
Kwa sababu walimwacha Mungu akaanza kuabudu miungu ya Baal.
And then fourth outcome, fourth consequence, verse 14.
Mstari wa 14.
The Lord handed them over to raiders.
Na Mungu akawapea kwa maadui wao.
Who plundered them, he sold them to their enemies. They were no longer able to resist.
Na hawangeweza
kustahimili. And no wonder he finishes in verse 15 by saying they were in great distress. Of course, God in his kindness carries on, his scripture carries on. He raised judges for them who would help them. You are the cycles of defeat, victory. That far, the nation that were God's people were in great distress. Allow me to mention a few contextual realities of where we are. Then I will make my point and we'll be home. Bishop Kimani will come at the end and pray for us and we shall be done. Now, for the realities of our context, it has been said, and it is true,
imesemekana ni kweli,
that Africa is the youngest continent on earth.
Ya kwamba Afrika right now. Ni ndogo katika dunia. Sasa hivi.
Ndio changa. Not because it was created last.
Si ya kwamba ilihumbwa ya mwisho.
But by ages, age pyramids.
Lakini katika hiyo mambo ya miaka.
Miaka ya wa wenyeji.
Miaka ya wenyeji.
We are the youngest continent.
Sisi ni wale ile ambayo ni ya mwanzo kabisa.
I see even here our average age is very decent.
Na naangalia hapa hata miaka yetu.
I have had the place of living and serving in different contexts.
Nilikuwa na nafasi ya kudumu katika muktadha tofauti.
If I was in a church in Europe, most likely your average age here would be 60 or 70.
Kama ningekuwa pale Ulaya miaka ingekuwa ni miaka 60.
And for us in Africa, actually we are looking at about 19, Kenya 19.5, and coming down. Miaka average, tuko 19 hivi, na kushuka.
Miaka 19 na kushuka.
And the second reality is this.
Ukweli wa pili ni huu.
It is proposed, projected that by 2050,
kuna mtazamo ya kwamba miaka ya mwaka wa 2050,
which is not that far,
ambayo haiko mbali sana,
it may well be
kama tutakuwe
that over half of the world's young people will be living in Africa.
Ya kwamba nusu ya watu vijana watakuwa wanaishi ni Afrika.
And if it is true,
na kama ni ukweli,
that those are realities we are faced with. Yes, I acknowledge also a third reality that majority of them are not urbanites like us. Still over 80% for church strategy, still over 80% of young people are still in the rural areas. That's where they identify with, that's where they locate. If that's established, the next implications arise.
Madhara ambayo itatokea ni hii.
And it is this.
Ni hii.
If it is true, and it is,
kama ni ukweli, ndiyo ni ukweli,
that human resource is the chief of all resources.
Ya kwamba watu ndiyo wamesimamia rasilimali yote.
Yani the capital is human resource. Eh?
Rasilimali ni ile ya watu.
And if it is true,
na ni kama ni ukweli,
and it is,
na ni ukweli,
that the youth are the cream of the human capital.
Ya kwamba vijana wao ndio rasilimali ya watu.
I propose to you,
ninawaambia hivi,
that the cream of humanity,
ya kwamba rasilimali ya watu,
in 2024,
kwa mwaka huu 2024,
is not in Europe, it's not in America, it is where? in Africa.
Iko hapa Afrika.
Now there's another game changer on this one.
Na pia kuna kubadilika hapa.
What is happening with Christianity if you look at it historically from the day of Jesus, early church, church fathers?
Nina inafanyika katika Ukristo kuanzia
mwanzo. All the way until now.
Hadi sasa.
Christianity, there's something we call the gradual migration of Christianity, where the periphery ends up becoming the center. You know, it keeps kind of spinning. Mwanzo ilikuwa Jerusalem, ikaendelea, 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 Rome ikakuwa on the periphery, ikasogea, ikasogea, Rome ikaishia kuwa center, ikaendelea, ikispin, 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 siyu, ikafika Europe, Europe, siyu, England, water, ends up being the center, sending many missionaries, ikanspin, ikaspin, ikazunguka duniani. Right now, do you know where it is spinning? It's in the global south. There is a west and the south, the north and the south. Yeah, when you say the global south, what I mean is countries that are down this way. Sio huko juu, huko juu kuna Europe na Marekani na Canada na now this lower part of the world is actually where Christianity is strongest.
Kristo huko katika
by numbers
dunia,
but also by quality.
Kwa jumla na pia kwa ukamilifu.
And here let me throw in a freebie. Some people say,
watu wengine wanasema hivi,
we want quality, not quantity.
Hatutaki wingi, tunataka uwema wa kitu.
Actually, the fact is,
kweli ni kwamba,
often you can't have quality without quantity.
Hawezi kuwa na uwema wa kitu kama hauna wingi wa kitu.
Because if you want big oranges, you have to have many to choose the big ones from.
Lazima ukue na machungwa mengi, utaweza kuchagua mazuri ndani yake.
So, if Christianity, by God's design historically, has happened such that right now,
kama ni Ukristo katika historia limefanyika,
the global south is where momentum is.
Ni katika dunia ambao kuko na wewe uzito.
Kumbuka when I say Christian momentum, I'm referring to influence to transform society with all that means. I'm speaking of missionary force to evangelize with all that means, etc., etc.
Naongelea kwamba ya uinjilisti na mambo kulingana na hiyo ya kudumisha neno la Mungu.
We get coupled two things here.
Tunapata mambo mawili hapa.
A young continent,
taifa ambalo ni dogo,
with Christianity being our side, the
na
momentum
na Kristo uko pande yetu.
But even in the global south,
lakini pale kusini kwa dunia,
we are looking at Asia, Africa, South America uko juu. Africa still shines.
Afrika bado iko na mwangaza.
Because if you look at Asia, kuna Uislamu, Hinduism, countries like China, India, multiple religions that have actually dominated the bigger percentage of the population.
Kuna dini kadha wakadha zile ambazo zimekuwa na umati mwingi wa watu.
Whereas in Africa the picture is a bit different.
Lakini Afrika,
so Africa becomes
tazamo ni tofauti.
And with Africa being the focus,
Afrika ikuwa ni mtazamo.
With Africa having the youth,
na iko na vijana.
Let me tell you something else.
Wacha nikuambie kitu kingine.
Based on the demographics we have mentioned and the trajectories,
kuhusiana na mtazamo ambao tumesema,
having already established the youth are the cream of,
kusema kwamba vijana ndio rasilimali,
na wako wapi?
Na wako Afrika.
Na wako Afrika. Can I then propose to you that the future of a lot of things,
ya kwamba hatima ya mambo mengi,
by God's providence is actually in the hands of Africa right now and Africans.
Yote yuko katika mikono ya Afrika na hapa Afrika.
Sababu vijana wanapanda, wazee wanashuka, si ndio? I studied geography. Countries that have young populations actually have momentum to rise. Those that have aging populations are actually declining even economically.
Nchi ambazo ziko na vijana ziko na uwezo wa kukua na zile ambazo ziko na wazee zinapungua.
So think of the future of global politics.
Angalia siasa za kidunia.
Is it going to be influenced by the aging populations or by the young, youthful populations?
Je, itakuwa ya vijana ama wale wazee?
Think of the future of world economics.
Angalia katika mambo ya uchumi ya dunia.
Think of the future of world technological innovations.
Teknolojia ya kimataifa ya dunia.
And I know many of us work in those spaces.
Najua wengi tunafanya kazi pale.
Big technology knows it. Big tech, big companies that are into tech, they are investing massively in Africa because this is where the people are.
Mataifa mengi ya teknolojia yamefanya utafiti hapa Afrika kwa sababu hapa ndio tuko na rasilimali.
Think of the future of socio-economic development and all the other spheres of human thriving.
Mambo yote ambayo yanakuza ubinadamu,
you cannot mention them without youth.
Hauwezi itaja bila vijana.
Children and youth, that space.
Watoto na vijana.
Because that's the future.
Hiyo ndio hatima.
So what's at stake here then? I hope I'm almost convincing you.
Niko hapa najaribu kukuleta.
What is at stake is not my family.
When you are shida sio familia yangu.
What is at stake is not even Kenya.
Sio Kenya too.
It's not even Africa.
Sio Africa too.
Actually the future of the world.
Hatima ya ulimwengu.
By God's design.
Jinyo mpango wa Mungu.
Especially in matters Christian transformation.
Ni mambo ya Ukristo.
Is where?
Iko wapi?
In the hands of Africans. That which used to be a problem.
Iko katika mikono ya Afrika.
Population growth. Human reproduction.
Kuhusu kukua. Uongezeko ya watu.
Na sisemi msipange uzazi. Lakini, that which used to be a problem.
Kila ambacho kilikuwa ni shida.
By God's design has actually become a timely strategic opportunity.
Kwa mpango wa Mungu imekuja ni nafasi nzuri sana ya Ukristo.
For us in Africa.
Sisi hapa Afrika.
And I know there are those who are looking to go majuu. May God bless you and his will be done. I won't pray that you go. I'll say his will be done because we need many young people here too. And by the way, many countries are trying to steal our young people. Do you know? Have you known?
Unajua mataifa mengi yanajaribu kuiba vijana wetu. Umejua hivyo?
Those aging populations. You know there are countries right now. And I have to be careful when I say this in churches because often I have people follow me up and say, hey, which country did you say?
Yeah.
There are countries right now which if you apply to visit your friend, first world countries, these are the huko. If you apply to visit your friend for 2 weeks, you are automatically given 10 years working permit.
Working visa.
Yeah? Or as long as your passport is valid. Ukienda renew passport zileo. Uende ukaapply visa ya kutembea siku tatu, watakupea miaka 10 ya kufanya kazi huko.
They give you 10 years.
Hiyo ni kuiba watu namna hii. Eh?
Kwa nini? Why?
Beware. Now, I have said the future of the world is massively in our hands.
Ya kwamba hatima ya dunia iko katika mikono yetu.
But you know what happened to Joshua and Caleb, eh?
Nini kilifanyika Joshua na Caleb?
What does that mean for us? If these people we see are the ones who are actually shaping not just the missionary enterprise of the future, not just the spirituality, everything.
Kila kitu.
By the way, that is included. Missionary enterprise is part of that. The future of missionary agency is squarely in the hands of Africans
because of the young people.
Also, let me encourage you.
Wacha nikutie moyo.
If you look at history, let me give you a very rapid brief history of the world, okay? A brief history of the world from a Christian perspective.
Katika mtazamo wa Ukristo.
Help me God, because this is a fantastic history and I want to do it in 2 minutes, 1 minute,
okay, 1.5.
The way Christianity has spread throughout time,
wakati Ukristo umeenea kwa wakati,
has been like this.
Imekuwa hivi.
There has been two major missionary mobilizing movements.
Umekuwa na,
shall I say seasons?
Msongo wa missionary.
You can stretch it and make it three, yeah? But I'll mention two, actually I'll mention three. Then I'll come to the fourth one, which is now. The first one was the Roman Empire.
Ilikuwa pale wa Rumi.
God in his wisdom, kuna kitu alifichia a certain culture, ili wakati wao ukifika, gospel explode. So the Roman Empire, actually the two major ones historically, then the preceding one, was the Roman Empire and the British Empire. The next one was during the USA, also dominated that state for a while, United States of America, and then Africa is now. In the Roman era, during the Roman Empire, God had somehow, before they even converted to Christianity, he had already given them certain things that would the gospel would ride on and accelerate. Their military, which could conquer and occupy anywhere, anyone, anytime.
Walikuwa na jeshi la kupigana na kuchukua kila mahali.
And bring the kingdom there as it is in Rome.
Na kuleta ufalme pale jinsi ilivyo kwa Warumi.
But there's an alignment there with the Lord's Prayer. Wherever the soldiers were sent, they were not supposed to really come back. They were supposed to go and establish there as it is at home.
Your kingdom come on earth as it is.
And so military, road building, technologies. You know, to this day you can go certain parts and find Roman roads. Built in Zizo or Roman wars because they had great technology that accelerated movement and when the gospel rode on that. And then of course the Greek language, which was a common language also, accelerated
technology
the gospel.
Nzuri na lugha nzuri wa Greek.
That was the Roman Empire. Then came the British Empire. When that movement got to Europe.
Ambayo iliingia pale wilaya.
Germany, UK, Netherlands, all these countries that massively sent missionaries. What did the gospel ride on? There was colonialism, the power of the gun. Countries like Great Britain, being such good managers and amazing managerial people, they could keep records, they could coordinate and govern vast
parts of the world.
Yeah? At one point, was it 3/4 of the world? Governed by a country this big, yeah? No wonder it's called Great Britain, to make up for the size. Yeah? Now, God used that.
Okay?
The gospel spread massively. Then it came the time of the USA. Business, enterprise, money.
Biashara.
So finance, God behind the mission. Masses of money accelerated the missionary enterprise during the season of the... Now, my question.
Swali
have
hii.
We got a great military now that it's our time?
Je, tumepata jeshi kubwa wakati huu?
Like the Romans.
Have kama we got Warumi.
Great road building technologies?
Je, tumekuwa na have kujenga barabara?
But like the British Empire, have we got, are we dominating and colonizing people?
Je, tunafanya ukoloni wa watu?
Have we got the power of the gun?
Je, tuko na uwezo wa
bunduki? Are we great managers who can dominate and manage vast territories?
Je, tunaweza miliki?
Or like the American era, have we got finance and commitments to actually resource mission?
Je, tuko na pesa ambayo inaweza katika umishonari?
Nusu nusu, eh? Yes and no, yes and no. But what is it that in our season God has kind of hidden for us? I've already given you a more Kenya. It is the young people. It is our youth. But if that be the case, what does it require of us now
sasa,
that we would steward these young people, that we would faithfully pass on our faith like Paul says to Timothy, 2 Timothy 2:2, that you should entrust the faith you have received to faithful people, faithful witnesses who will pass it on to others.
Yep.
What does it require of us?
Je, inahitajika nini kwetu ili tuweze kupitisha imani hii?
To be able to do that effectively.
Tuifanye kwa umakinifu.
So that we do not drop the ball.
Ili tusiweze achilia tena ama kutojumika.
So that we do not break the chain.
Ili tusiweze kata mtindo huo.
Let me bring you even closer home.
Wacha nikulete kwa ukaribu.
I've given you the general picture of the demographics in Africa and...
Nimekuonyesha mtazamo ule wa dunia na paka Afrika.
And here I'm not biased, eh?
Na hapa sina,
we said Africa is the youngest continent. We've already kind of put Asia aside and South America and we are in Africa.
Tuko hapa Afrika.
Again, there are entities actually, organizations that are researching the whole space of youth. One of them is called One Hope. They might even have representatives here or staff. And I've had conversations with them. And you know, actually, they are relocating their focus to Kenya. I'll tell you why.
Wale ambao wanafanya utafiti kwa vijana wameweka makazi yao, makao yao hapa Kenya.
They have told me, having studied Africa,
wameangalia Afrika,
there are youth all over.
Kuna vijana kila mahali.
But there are certain other predisposing factors.
Lakini kuna mambo fulani
which affect the efficiency and effectiveness of the youth in the different parts of Africa. North Africa, for example, countries like Nigeria have a vast youth.
Kama Nigeria wako na vijana wengi sana.
But political instability, Boko Haram and the rest, yeah?
Lakini mambo ya kisiasa.
There is instability. Then you go to South Africa. You know us Kenyans, we like
Africa
looking
kusini.
And admiring South Africa, which is fantastic, by the way. But South Africa, again,
pale Africa
the
kusini.
Consequences of apartheid and social division and conflict.
Mambo ya siasa, vita.
They are youth, but when you look at the other factors,
kuna vijana, lakini kuna mambo
they are not so favorable.
Mazingira sio mazuri.
What does that leave? It leaves the East African region.
Inaangalia
you
Africa,
come, you zoom into East Africa now, and you're like, hey, okay, sawa, Somalia, Rwanda, Burundi, Uganda, South Sudan, Tanzania, and Tanzania. Yes, they have a lot of youth.
Tanzania wako na vijana wengi.
And I've worked there for many years, my family and I. But the education levels.
Lakini kiwango cha masomo.
Yeah. Look at Uganda, my friend Museveni, I said he's, I'm not sure he calls me his friend, but he's mine. You know what I mean? again, if you look at their population dynamics, their economics, their political dynamics, do you know what you're left with? You're left with Kenya. And actually people are looking at Kenya as a country that will shape world Christianity for a minimum of the next 200 years if Jesus does not delay. But that's reality research based. But are we aware of it? Have we woken up to that?
Tunaelewa hiyo.
And what's the force? The young people.
Na rasilimali ni vijana.
How do we pass on our faith to them so that it is true of them? And this is, as we draw towards a close, let me ask a few questions. Because I told you today is not conventional. Who is going to teach our young people? Because like Joshua, if we say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord na shauri yenu.
If we say, kama Yoshua, kama mimi na nyumba yangu tutamtumikia Mungu na nyinyi mbaki pale.
I dare boldly say to you today.
Na kuambia kwa uhakika leo.
And in the name of the Lord.
Kwa jina la Bwana.
Jesus Christ.
Yesu Kristo.
That if he stays in your house.
Kama anaishi katika nyumba yako.
It will die in the house.
Itakufia pale kwenye nyumba.
If he stays in the house.
Akiishi pale nyumbani.
He dies in the house.
Atakufa pale kwenye nyumba.
There are some things you have to release.
Kuna mambo fulani lazima uyaachilie.
For it to thrive.
Ili iweze kuenea.
It's like I go out and catch a nice njiwa, eh?
Ninyi chukue pale nje.
Njiwa, the bird. And I admire it so much I contain it in my house. You know what happens? It dies in the house.
Itakufa pale.
But if I take it out and feed it and let it fly,
nikiachilia iweze kupaa kule nje,
it thrives.
Itaendeleza vizuri.
Who is teaching our young people?
Nani anafundisha vijana wetu?
What kind of commitment do we have to them?
Ni uwekezaji gani tuko nao juu yao?
How are we doing?
Tunafanya namna gani?
In passing on our faith to the next generation.
Kupitisha imani yetu kwa kizazi kijacho.
And how are we handling them in the church? Are they center and what? Front and center? Are they profiled and foregrounded? Do we even recognize that this is precious? This is actually the best in God's strategy to reach the world that he has caused us to have right now.
Mpango wa Mungu kufikia dunia ambayo ametuandalia sisi tuwe nao.
And the scripture is very clear.
Na maandiko yako kwa hakika.
That if we are to pass on our faith to the next generation,
kama tutaweza kupitia imani yetu kwa kizazi kijacho,
we must do it intentionally.
Lazima tuifanye kwa kumaanisha.
And it must not be the faith of mom and dad.
Na isikue tu imani ya baba na mama.
Because if that's the way it is, they will have little commitment, little interest. It will mean nothing to them.
Kama ni hivyo watahawata kuwa na kujukumika sana.
What generation are we raising in our homes?
Je, ni kizazi kipi ambacho tunaonyesha pale nyumbani?
The place of the family altar?
Katika madhabahu ya familia.
What generation are we raising in our churches?
Je, tunaamsha kizazi kipi katika kanisa letu?
And what generation are we raising in our communities?
Na katika maisha yetu tunatoa vizazi kiasi gani?
Who is teaching, training them in these three key areas?
Na nani ambaye anawafunza katika sehemu hizi za maana sana?
The greatest commandment. Remember they were to teach their children that, eh?
Ilikuwa ni amri ya kwamba wafundishe watoto wao.
They were even given a structure of how to do it.
Na wakaambiwa jinsi wataifanya.
Who is teaching them to love the Lord their God with their all?
Nani anawafundisha wapende Mungu wao na mioyo yao?
And who is teaching them about the greatest priority?
Na nani anawafundisha kuhusu mitazamo ya kipekee?
By the way, loving the Lord with you all, if you're taking notes, I see some people are taking notes. Mark chapter 12, verse 28-34. And the second one, greatest priority, Matthew chapter 6, 33. That seek first, not money. Seek first, not position. Seek first, not following on the social media. Seek first. Who is teaching our children, the next generation, that?
Nani anawafundisha mambo kama haya?
And who is teaching them the great commission?
Nani anawafundisha mwito mkuu?
That at the end of the day, it's not about me, myself, and I.
Si kuhusu tu mimi mwenyewe.
It's about going to the whole world, preaching the gospel, teaching them to obey everything he commanded, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and on and on. Matthew 28, 18 to 20. And also, how are we treating our young people? It reminds me of
1
Samuel 17.
Samuel wa kwanza 17.
And this is very concerning and very sobering for me.
Hii inanimaanishia sana kwangu.
Remember, I told you, and as we conclude, that I am a seriously interested party.
Ya kwamba mimi najihusisha sana katika mambo haya.
Are we compassionate to our young people?
Je, tuko na upendo kwa wao vijana wetu?
Are we gentle and loving? Are we practicing the fruit of the Holy Spirit?
Je, tunafekeza
matunda
ya Roho Mtakatifu tunapowashughulikia?
If there is anything I see in 1 Samuel 17, David and Goliath and Saul.
Ninapoangalia pale kwa Samuel wa kwanza kupenda saba kuhusu Daudi, Goliath na Sauli.
It was that every generation has its own giants and the Lord does not change. The word of God does not change. But my goodness me. Do the weapons of their of welfare, the techniques, does the Lord innovate?
Ya kwamba kila kizazi kiko na majitu yake, lakini teknolojia na mambo ya kupigana nayo ni tofauti.
Could it be that we are burdening our young people with our weapons?
Je, tunaweza kuwa tunawekeza silaha zetu kwao ambazo hawawezi kuzitumia?
You remember what Saul did when David volunteered?
Unajua kile ambacho Saul alifanya wakati Daudi alitokezea?
He knew how people go to battle.
Alijua jinsi watu wanavyoenda kwenye vita.
His armor akamwekelea.
Akamvalisha mavazi yake ya vita.
His helmet.
Akampatia kofia.
His sword.
Akampatia silaha.
His shield.
Na ngao yake. Ngao yake.
Maybe not the helmet because he was a king, so he would have compromised his authority. But alimvisha nini? Na akambea. The young man could not move.
Daudi hangaweza kutembea kwa mavazi yake.
What did he do?
Alifanya nini?
He put them down.
Akayaweka chini.
He picked some stones.
Akachukua silaha zake mawe.
He had a sling.
Na akakuwa
mpaka Goliath anauliza aya kwani nimekuwa mbwa ndio nikujie na ma na tumawe.
And Goliath yeah? Even wondered, am I a dog that you are coming to me with stones?
Could it be that there are times when you see our young people and the youth and the young generation approaching their own battles in the Lord by yeah. faith?
Tunaweza angalia wanapo
they do it so differently. I'm like aya hapana, hiyo haiwezekani.
Wanapigana yeah? vita vyao katika Bwana kwa mbinu zingine, tunashangaa hiyo haiwezekani.
And my call there, please can we not burden the next generation
tusiwaekeze mizigo kizazi kijacho
with what worked for us,
kile ambacho kilifanyika kwetu.
Can we be more discerning, and myself included,
tukue watu wa kufanya utafiti
of what the Lord is doing and how we can compassionately encourage and empower and support
kile vile Mungu anaweza saidia na waekeze nguvu katika vijana.
And finally, what does it look like in Africa?
Hapa Afrika.
How do we steward the youth?
Tunaweza wafundisha vijana wa Afrika namna gani?
Because really, for us, because here I'm talking about our children and our children's children, eh?
Naongea kuhusu watoto wetu na watoto wa watoto wetu.
If you have children, I'm talking of yours. If you have no children, I'm talking of the ones you're going to have.
Naongelea kuhusu watoto wako na wale ambao unataka kuwa nao kwa imani.
How do we steward them? Because it's a precious resource right now.
Tutaweza kuwafundisha
for God's kingdom purposes.
Kwa sababu ni rasilimali ya maana sana kwa vizazi vijavyo.
Stewardship must be at the core of it.
Kuwafundisha mambo haya lazima iwe ni msingi.
And how do we do that, my friends, through the leverage of love? How do we love them into good purposes of God?
Tutawapenda namna gani waingie katika makusudi ya Mungu?
Instead of threatening, how do we love them?
Japokuwa tunaweza kuwatishia, tunawapenda namna gani ili wafanye makusudi ya Mungu katika upendo?
Into that. And this is where I call on my friend and my senior bishop Jimmy Kimani to come and pray for us.
And
to help us make a response, because this is a serious and an urgent call for this time.
Huu ni mwito ambao unahitajika wakati huu
for us all.
Kwetu sisi wote.